Good evening, everyone. This is Lisa Culverwell. I am the owner of Miss Elsie's Bookkeeping here in Crowley, Texas, and I am so happy to be here. Oh, this is our ramp up week, and it's going to remain ramped up until the series is over. So we're looking at right around first week to second week of February when the series might be done, and then I might be looking at something else to start doing videos on. So I always tell everybody why I do this, but before I get started, I would love for people to please introduce yourselves. I always love to get to know all of my viewers and to find out why they are here. While we are waiting on more people to show up, and hopefully some comments, we'll go on ahead and talk about why I do this. So I always tell everybody that the reason I'm doing this is because of small businesses. Small business owners, especially this year due to COVID, may not be able to afford bookkeeping. That does not mean that I want them to fail in any regard. I want them to succeed. I want them to succeed in the management of their business, but also in knowing what the financial health of their business is. This is not to go out and get a $1 million loan so that you can expand to a 500,000 square foot warehouse or anything like that. It is just so that you know what you are doing, whether you're profitable or not, and where your money is going. We want you to remain open during these trying times. And this is the only way that you're going to know for sure that everything is okay and whether or not you're going to make it. So, this series today is episode number 8. We are discussing financial milestones. Excuse me. We're discussing financial milestones today. And so we always get into a review of the previous episode. So let's get into that. So as you remember, last Wednesday, we went through the different types of entities. And it's so funny that all of this happened on the same exact day. I was doing something else where I had to put in entities, and it just so happened that everything that I needed was already there at my fingertips just for that course, for this video. So that was perfect. So just to recap, a sole proprietorship, of course, is owned by one person. It can be a husband or wife, or husband and wife. It cannot be any other type of partnership. So we've got freelancers, consultants, service professionals, retail stores with only one person at the helm. And again, you have so many different types of retail stores out there that are owned by corporations and LLCs. This is a special type of retail store that you don't find very often. Another type is a general partnership. This also includes limited partnerships. So a general partnership is where all partners actively manage the business and share in the profits and losses. A limited partnership is limited. There's two of them. There's limited liability partnerships, which shields all partners from personal liability. And there's also the limited liability limited partnership. It's a mouthful, I know. Which includes some liability protection for general partners. Next, we have limited liability corporations, LLCs, such as mine. You've got the general LLC, which is a limited liability for all members. And then you've got your professional limited liability companies, which are for professionals such as doctors and accountants. Corporations, there are several kinds, and we went through a lot of information last week. You've got the C Corp or C Corporation, which is composed of shareholders, directors, and officers. An S Corp is taxed as a pass-through entity. And I know that I don't have everything, the pros and cons on here like I did last week, but the C Corp and S Corp are both the ones that have the most tax the beneficial taxes. Professional corporation is a corporate structure for professionals, again, such as doctors and accountants. And a B Corp is for a for-profit corporation that's certified for meeting social and environmental standards. And then finally, there's nonprofits, which is a corporation formed primarily to benefit the public interest rather than earn a profit. These would include religious organizations, human and animal rights, some environmental. We already discussed the B corporations, which an environmental corporation is probably going to fall under that. But I would imagine that there are actual nonprofits that also focus on environmental impact. Charities such as Alzheimer's Association, the Cancer Foundation. There's so many of them. Organizations that help the homeless. The list just goes on and on and on. It's never ending. I always call it the meat and the potatoes. So we're getting into the meat and potatoes of our discussion now. So we're discussing six important financial milestones for small businesses. Now, this is going to kind of overlap a general business plan, so I guess. And it might sound a little bit salesy, but these are the actual financial milestones. So they do overlap. And so what those six milestones are, and we'll get into these, is to create a profitable business model, 2, keep customers coming back, 3, find a marketing strategy unique to your brand, which is realistic and scalable, 4, hire the best talent and train a solid team, 5, gain authority in your industry, and finally, 6, start making more sales. So your business milestone number 1, create a profitable business model. Why should you have a business model? It tells a story of how your entire business works. And you should ask yourself 3 core questions. Who's your client? What does your client value? And how do you deliver that value at the right cost? Now, when I say, what does your client value? When you first ask that question, it's a little bit confusing because people might think, well, okay, do they value me? Do they value my business? Do they value what I sell? What exactly are we asking? So what does your client value? Do you sell t-shirts? If you sell t-shirts, but you have value included in that might pose more towards a certain ethnicity, a certain religion. There's just about anything that you can go after. Then you might be pointing towards one of those, and you're looking at your clients going, okay, what are you going to value more? Are you going to value this over this? Or it could be something that you add. In other words, there's a value add sort of thing. For instance, I do value added pricing for my business. What that means is some businesses will price out their services based on an hourly rate. Other businesses will price out their business based off of a set dollar figure per transaction. And it requires a lot of thought. It requires a lot of calculation. It requires me or the other person to really look at the books and figure out what's going on beforehand. For me, when I say I do value-added pricing, it means I have a very simple strategy. I look at I look at the gross profit for the entire year, the yearly gross profit. And then I take a percentage of that and I divide it by 12, and that's what I charge. It makes it very simple. So even if they were to have 50 transactions or 500 transactions a month, it wouldn't really matter because it bases everything off of their gross profit, so that when they grow, I grow. What that means is when they grow, it means I'm going to have to do more work. So there's value added things that you can do. It's giving things to your clients for free. It's making things easier. So it could be that t-shirt, you give them a free sample, or you give them a free hat with the t-shirt, whatever it is, that could be your value. Okay, business, and did we go through? Okay, I really don't like this setup. Did we? Yes, we went through all the questions. Okay, so business milestone number 2, keep your customers coming back. Landing your first repeat client will give you confidence in your business and motivation to keep going. So I know that for myself, when I have my clients coming back and saying, yes, we want you to continue working on everything, it's an amazing feeling. You almost get a high off of it. How to get a repeat client, excuse me, through personal recommendations, existing contacts, and cold calling. Personally, cold calling, I absolutely hate doing. I know how it feels. You know, we all know how it feels to get a cold call and all you want to do is hang up on the person. And 9 times out of 10, that's what we end up doing. But then you get that one person that decides to keep you on the phone forever, you know, AKA my husband, who likes to keep you on the phone forever. And really just playing around, until you're too tired to stay on and you hang up. So I don't want to be the person making those phone calls. I will go door to door before I do cold calling. So, but you know, sometimes cold calling is someone else's cup of tea. It's just not mine. Milestone number 3, find a marketing strategy unique to your brand that's realistic and scalable. So you want to tackle as much of the marketing as you can. Outsource once, and I spelled it wrong. It's once, not one. Outsource once you know what works. Taking an active role in your marketing campaign will strengthen 2 key talents, which is delegation and determination. Now, believe me, I was more shocked to be putting all of this up tonight than anyone else, because honestly, I'm probably furthest from a marketing and sales guru than anyone else. So, but I knew that this would be beneficial to someone else. I did my research and here we go. So now I can actually implement all of this into my business as well. So it's not just me helping you. It's all of you helping me through this. Milestone number 4. Hire the best team, the best talent, and train a solid team. This exciting milestone will grow your business by leaps and bounds. I know that I have partnered with some people personally for my business recently, actually as of yesterday. And we're not going to get into it right now because it's not even public yet. But I have actually reached out to a couple of people that I'm bringing in as contractors, and that's my very first two contractors. So that's exciting, scary and exciting. Create a stellar employee training program before you hire your first employee. And test the water by hiring a virtual assistant, also known as a VA or contractor. A virtual assistant can help you establish that highly sought after work-life balance. Something I sure do need sometimes. Milestone number 5, gain authority in your industry. The internet is the fastest route to becoming an authority. Create the type of content that your industry needs and will appreciate, and then give it away for free. It's that value add that we were talking about. Get involved in local events that allow you to share your expertise. This would be networking events, you know, B&I or your local chamber. You could also, the chamber might actually have chamber events where they may, I believe once or twice a year when COVID's not here, of course, they will allow a large event, a large scale networking event to happen and actually bring people in that are not members of the chamber in hopes of bringing them in. And these are booths. People rent out a booth, they put up their banner, they hand out their materials, their business cards, flyers, pamphlets, whatever. Some of them have free gifts. It's an amazing way to really get to know your local businesses and whether you can help them. And it's, I would love to participate in something like that, but we just don't have them right now. So hopefully next year. I don't know about you, but I can't wait for 2021 to come. I'm sure the rest of you probably feel the same. Coupling speaking. Okay, no, I had to look, make sure there aren't any comments. Coupling speaking engagements with stellar online content will turn you into a sought-after authority. And finally, number 6, start making more sales. Set a specific goal for sales. Without a goal, the business will stagnate. Having a goal will help you to continue moving forward toward your target growth. And determine an ambitious yet achievable dollar figure for your business. Only you'll know what number to set as your target, but once set, make sure everyone on your team knows about it. And of course, by doing all of this, you can be the successful 50%. Yes, that number seems daunting, 50%, but yeah, a lot of small businesses fail in the first year. So why don't we all be that 50%? Your business can be among that 50% that makes it past its first 5 years and then onward to 10 and 20. You'll need to work on business milestones and goals to keep you and your team focused, but it's possible. So that's it in a nutshell. Okay, there we go. A lag in my computer. So I hope that everyone is having a great evening. I know that this is actually a fairly short episode tonight. We usually try to take it to about 30 minutes and right now it's at 20. But we do have two more coming. So tomorrow we are discussing, the fun part. We are doing an introduction to QuickBooks Online. So I know that I walked you through a tiny bit of QuickBooks Online a couple of weeks ago, just so that you could see what a chart of accounts looked like and a couple of reports, but we're going to get into a little bit more. I'm going to show you what the actual software looks like and where you can find everything. And hopefully it will help you. And of course, I always say, you have any questions at all regarding QuickBooks Online, I am a pro advisor for QuickBooks. And any help with your bookkeeping at all, you've got questions, you contact me. I am on Facebook, and my website is Miss Elsie's Bookkeeping.com. Miss Elsie's Bookkeeping.com. And I also have a YouTube channel. Thursday, we will be discussing assets and liabilities. We're going to start breaking things down so that you understand them a little bit better. So assets and liabilities, their importance, and how to record them. So get your pen and paper ready for Thursday, for tomorrow possibly, and maybe even record the video, because I really want you to get all of this down. I'm here to help you. I'm here to help you succeed. And in order to succeed, you need to understand what each of these things are and what they're for and how to record each thing. Because I want you to know what your financial business is doing. Your financial health is doing. And without knowing the financial health, I'm sorry, but you're almost doomed to fail, because you're not going to know if you're making profit. You're not going to know how much you're spending in expenses and then what your net profit is, if there's anything. So, and once we get out of all of this COVID stuff and start to go back to a semi-normal life, then once your business starts to finally grow again, and hopefully it already is, but once it starts growing again, then the more you know, the better off you're going to be, because then you'll be able to figure out when you can make those amazing business decisions, ones that will allow you to bring in more employees, expand, maybe move to a bigger building, buy a property, whatever it is. So, but you all have a wonderful evening, and I will see y'all tomorrow night, 7 p.m. Central Time. Introduction to QuickBooks Online. Thank you very much.